Now, to come to Salwa Jadum, the government has, Chhattisgarh government has officially claimed that it is a spontaneous people's movement. This is what they continue to claim despite increasing evidence. And that it was Mao's retaliation against those who had joined the Salwa Jadum which forced them to leave and come to camps. So they say that there is no state sponsorship. These photos were taken by a local journalist in Kaunta in February 2006, the first rally in this area. And you see the on the left, the collector and the leader of the opposition, Mahendra Karma, flagging off the rally. And we know from a lot of evidence, I filed a case in the Supreme Court on Salwa Jadum, and we have a lot of official evidence now that it was completely sponsored by the government. The government of Chhattisgarh said that the police role was confined to providing security for the rallies, but it's quite clear that it was more than just providing security, it was actually organizing the rallies. These are special police officers and others setting off to persuade villagers to join Salwa Jadum. And this is what the government of Chhattisgarh has called on different occasions an unarmed peaceful movement, the fragrance of the forest, a Gandhian movement. Now, what these Salwa Jadum rallies did, people, the sarpanches of the villages were told that if they did not get their villages to come and participate in these rallies, they would be fined, people would be beaten. So villagers would come to these rallies. You have these young men who were armed by the administration, running amok, burning villages, killing people, raping women. In most cases, people were not even described as killed in encounters. Their bodies were just left to rot. And these are people who are not Naxalites. These are not armed village people. These are just ordinary villagers working in their fields, cutting firewood, being caught by the Salwa Jadum when unable to run away, being sick at home and therefore unable to run, and being caught and killed. According to official figures, 644 villages were affected by Salwa Jadum. There was large-scale arson. The NHRC has also found that there was large-scale arson and looting of property. And you have village upon village in Bastar being burnt like this. The Maoists retaliated. Ever since Salwa Jadum began, the Maoist violence has gone up exponentially. So between 1968 and 98, there were 70 killings in that 30-year span by the Maoists. Since Salwa Jadum began, it's risen. The government provides figures of people killed by the Maoists. They do not provide figures of people killed by the security forces in Salwa Jadum. So all the media reporting has been one-sided, but the fact is that people are being killed by both sides and there has been a huge loss of life. The government appointed special police officers. This is a policy they're replicating across the country. Now, if you look at who these special police officers are, many of them were former Maoists who were arrested and then forced to work as SPOs. Many were minors who thought they would get a government job, police job. Forms were coming to their village, so they thought, okay, let's sign up. Some are criminal elements, thekedars and others who saw an opportunity to make money. And one of the biggest tragedies is that a government which has a million-strong army should use children to fight this war on the front lines. The government of Chhattisgarh has maintained that it has not recruited any minors, but you can see from these photos that these are children. We're sending off our children to fight against insurgents from their own. I mean, this makes no sense to me, and I think you will appreciate that the kind of cover-up that we've had on this situation is sort of beyond the bounds of any lawlessness. Government claimed that people came to camps voluntarily. We know from testimonies given by in 2007, local members of the CPI filed a case before the Supreme Court in which they annexed 200 testimonies by villagers. And I'll just read out to you one of them. 2 years ago, the headman of our village and neighboring villages who had joined the Salwa Jadum came and threatened us that if we did not leave our villages and join the Salwa Jadum camps in Geedam, the police, SPOs, Naga forces, and Salwa Jadum would jointly kill us. Therefore, all of us out of fear left our homes and came to the Salwa Jadum camp. Another testimony. In 2006, the Salwa Jadum came to my village and burnt all 107 houses. Then they took us to Erabor camp. So we have about 200 testimonies like this before the Supreme Court. In the first phase of forced evacuation, people were moved to camps like this. They were shattered. They were separated from their villages. There was, their lives had come to a standstill. There was corruption in the camps. The government said it was implementing hearts and minds and providing relief, but relief was siphoned off. There was a lot of corruption. People were starving in the camps. Many villagers, about a lakh, we estimate, fled to Andhra Pradesh to escape from this violence. A recent report in 2009 found that many of the children were suffering from third grade malnutrition. They live at the mercy of the Andhra Pradesh Forest Department. In the last year or so, some of them had started coming back, thanks to Himanshu, who had started resettling people, and also the CPI, which had been encouraging people to come back. And now, because of this Operation Green Hunt, many of them are again fleeing to Andhra. There is a number of rapes. We have a number of testimonies. This is one. 2 days after we reached the camp, the SPOs of the camp asked me and some other girls to come with them because they wanted to interrogate us. They took seven of us in a vehicle out of the camp to the nearby forest. There they raped all of us again and again. They threatened us, saying if we go back, they would kill us. This is a photo that we took in 2006 where a woman showed what happens when the Salvajadum and security forces come to the village. They make women lie down, beat them. Schooling, health, Anganwadis, ration shops, everything has collapsed. The government of India, the CRPF actually says, you know, beyond this point is Pakistan. If you go beyond this, we are not responsible. So people are like, no, the media is not allowed to go. Andhra papers reported recently that there were shoot on site orders if journalists came to report on what was happening. It's really like this is an area beyond the control of the Indian government controls the highways, and they will not let anybody go inside to find out what's happening. There are sort of raids by the CRPF inside. The Maoists come out and raid outside. So there is, it's, you know, it's a complete war zone. People are now, there's a state of curfew. People are not going out after 6 in the evening because of this Operation Green Hunt. They can't go to their fields because of this curfew. The wild animals have eaten up their fields. As it is, this is a drought year. We're talking about a war situation. In 2007, Ramchandra Guha, the historian E.S. Sarma, who was former secretary to the government of India, and I filed a petition before the Supreme Court. And in 2008, the Supreme Court asked the NHRC to investigate what was happening. And in the NHRC report found the Salvajadum guilty on a number of counts and has made a number of recommendations. And the Supreme Court asked the Chhattisgarh government to show an action taken report on the recommendations of the NHRC by the 31st of January. Since then, those recommendations include compensating victims, rehabilitating them, inquiry into all cases, etc. Since then, the Chhattisgarh government has done nothing. They have managed to get repeated adjournments in the court. And in fact, if you listen to all the BJP leaders on the television, they keep saying that they have the case and the Supreme Court has said nothing, when in fact, they are supposed to produce evidence before the Supreme Court of having taken action on which, you know, they haven't done anything.